I want to go to Hebrew this morning, chapter 9 of the book of Hebrew. And we're going to begin reading here at verse number 8. We're going to read here. It said, the Holy Ghost, this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest while the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure of the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience, which stood in meats and drinks and divers washings and carnal ordinances imposed upon them until the time of reformation or reformation, whichever way you want to pronounce that. Let's put that reformation back up there again. It means to put an end to wrong. That's what that means. It means to call that person to give up harmful or immoral practices or persuade to adapt a better way of life. It's the correction of evil, abuse of error. So the law was given until the time would come that God would correct the lives of human beings. Hallelujah. Oh, I know you haven't heard that before, but it's right here. He goes on down to tell you, explain that to you. Okay, let's go to verse 12. He said, neither by the blood of goats and of calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctified to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? When Christ came on the scene, he came to purge dead works out of the mind. He came to purge sin out of your thinking. This is how he illustrated it. He said, the law said, thou shalt not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say unto you, Jesus is purging a conscience. I say unto you that if you're angry with your brother without a cause, you're in danger of the same judgment. He said, the law said, you shall not commit adultery. He come to purge the conscience. Let's read this again. Hallelujah. Verse 14. How much more shall the blood of Christ through the eternal Spirit offer himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Now, he's telling you Christ's blood is supposed to take certain things out of your mind that is not like God. And this is not hard. It's not something, it is truly God's grace, because it's truly not something you can do on your own. Now that, all of the preachers have that right. I'm the first to admit you can't do this without him. I'm the first to admit. But I got relatives here. I got friends with me here, right in our service. I see my cousin Gary back there. Lift your hand up, Gary. That's Sister Darlene's brother. Glad to have him with me. And the reason why I mention him, he remembered me from 13, 14 years old. He remembered me racing cars. He remembered me chasing women. He remembered drinking liquor. I taught him all his bad habits. But he knew when he went to the army, he didn't know what went on. Because when he came back, he saw a man totally different from the man he left. I didn't brag on or go out and when I looked at a woman, looking her up and down, checking her out, that was gone. My mind had been changed. It wasn't that I had to start working so hard. Oh, Lord, don't let me look no more. Oh, no, Lord. Oh, Jesus, help me, Lord. No, it wasn't that. If that was going on, I'd have been still at the altar. Lord, save me. I ain't right. But what happened was when the Spirit of God came in me, it brought in God's mind in me. It brought in God's personalities. I looked at women and I wanted to see them saved. I didn't want to send them to hell. Did I ever have some temptations? Yes, I did. But they wouldn't see it. When I felt a certain way, I was on my knees asking God, God, you got to get this thing out. And the devil tried to trick me with this. Because he tried to make me believe that my little periodically of times of thoughts, mine not being exactly right every time. He tried to make me believe that was me, a convicted criminal again. And for a little while, he almost tricked me. But I was so honest that he couldn't trick me long. I went to my friend that was a preacher before me. And I said, man, I don't know what's going on here. I said, man, look like I can't look at a lady. If I look at her, I'm looking at the wrong spot. I said, man, I must not be saved. I said, I'm looking at the wrong thing and thoughts coming to me telling me I'm lusting. I knew I couldn't look to lust. He looked me in the face. He said, man, he said, I'm going to tell you something. He said, the devil is an accuser of the brotherhood. He said, I'm going to tell you what's happening. He said, that's not you. He said, Satan is reminiscent of what you left on. And he's trying to bring that back to you. He's trying to make you think on it again. I said, that's not me. He said, no, I'm going to tell you what's you. He said, when you're on your knees praying and asking God to deliver you, he said, that's what you are. Hallelujah. He said, when you did those things before, he said, you went around bragging on it. So, but now just the mere thought of it gets you disturbed. Just the fact you thought on it, you don't like it. He said, that's what you are now. He said, I owe you would have been trying to get a telephone number. I owe you would have been looking up and down. But now God has made you new and the devil trying to condemn you. You rebuke the devil and tell him he's a liar and the father of it. Shout glory to God, somebody. Man, he had me so confused one while that I had said, well, I ain't going to witness. I'm just going to witness to the men. I don't have no problem now. Tell you what, when he told me what that was not me, that was the tempter coming to me. See, that's why you got to walk by faith now. When God has done something for you, don't let this little, any little temptation make you think you can't last now. Just any little old feeling now, because you feel it, feeling a little like I'm feeling the backslide. No, I'm not fixing the backslide. I'm fixing to move through this thing. The devil, you's a liar. You trying to braid it. I don't care what I felt. I know what happened to me at the altar. I know what came inside of me. I know where my mind is. Shout glory to God, somebody. I'm telling you. So I begin to tell. He said, you tell that devil next time he tell you that. Because I made up my mind I wasn't going to witness to that because I wasn't going to lose what I had. I mean, this peace I had now, I had so much joy. I was so full of happiness. I wasn't going to lose it. I was treasuring this thing. Hallelujah. And now he told me, he said, man, you tell that devil next time he do that, you just tell him that ain't you. He said, devil, I ain't lusting, you lusting. I mean, so the next day, a couple of days after that, I was witnessing. I always wanted to tell folk what God had done for me. And I began to tell some lady I saw at a Walmart or somewhere, and I was ministering to her about Jesus Christ. And he old thought coming, yeah, there you go lusting again. There you go lusting. And I almost forgot about what my friend told me. And I almost was finna drop my head and walk away. And then he said, you know, that ain't you. That's the devil lying to you. I spoke to her. She never heard me, but I said, you lying devil. I said that in my mind. You lying devil. That's you lusting, ain't? I began to preach to that woman. I said, lady, God can free you. God can set you free. You can be a new person. And I'm going to tell you something. From that point, that became my strongest part of my Christian walk. But I didn't get to my, I had trials and other things, but as far as the women was concerned, I became so strong after I stood to the devil and let God's grace, that's what Paul was talking about.
Paul wasn't talking about I fell down, get up, fell down, grace. When I prayed to the Lord, you know, he just got up, got me up. No, Paul said, when I prayed to the Lord, I was weak. He said, but then I found out I was stronger when I was weak. Something stood on the inside of me. And it stood up. And I began to resist that. This Christian warfare is a warfare. It is a warfare. The Bible said we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places and rulers of darkness of this world. We are wrestling against the devil and himself and all his angels in high positions. But we can conquer every one of them. Hallelujah. Let's go over here. In verse number 14, say, how much more shall the blood of Christ through the eternal spirit offer himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Chapter 10 of Hebrew. The law having a shadow of good things to come and not the very image of the thing can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect. See, the law could not make you fulfill Jesus' commandment when he said, be ye therefore perfect. See, many of you want to just scratch that out and change it to something else. The law couldn't make you that. If you stay under the law, then you can't make yourself overcome and live a perfect life. For then would they not have ceased to be offered, because the worshiper once purged should have no more conscience of sin. When the worshiper is purged, he should have no more conscience of sin. Let's go to verse 4. For it is impossible that the blood of bulls and goats can take away sin. Verse number 5. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he said, sacrifices and offerings thou wouldest not, but a body thou hast prepared me. That's very important, church. Grace changes your body. Grace changes your heart. The Bible said, this is my covenant. I will put my laws in their hearts and write them in their minds. He said, let's read verse 5 again. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he says, sacrifices and offerings thou wouldest not, but a body thou hast prepared me. And burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin thou hast had no pleasure. Then said I, this is the new covenant. Then said I, lo, I come, in the volume of the book it is written of me to do thy will, O God. We must understand the old law that was offerings up of sacrifices and bulls and goats. But God has never enjoyed seeing a bunch of bloody animals and you still doing wrong. God has never enjoyed a group of bloody dead animals everywhere and you still cursing when you feel like it. Hallelujah. God has never liked that, even when he accepted it. But the sad thing about today's Christian church, the Christian church today is going back to the works of the law. And they're doing it in Jesus' name. They're going back, oh no, you're not killing a bunch of bulls and goats. But you are not living a life pleasing to God. You will do wrong and expect Jesus' blood to take it. You go and cuss Jesus' blood, got it. You go and you cuss somebody out and rob, steal, Jesus' blood, got it. You are doing the same thing that the law did. That's what it was. And that's what you're doing when you have that mindset. Let me go over and show you what this psalmist is talking about. From Psalms 40. This is where the writer in Hebrew got it from. Let's read it. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Here it is, sacrifices and offerings thou did not desire. Now, this is in the Old Testament, even while it was going on. God is speaking of a new change in the law. Sacrifices and offerings thou did not desire. My ears has thy open. You got to open up your ears to hear the truth. Why did the man say, I open up my ears? Jesus often said it like this. He that has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. You can very well sit in this church and close your ears to what I'm telling you. You can hear me reading it, see me showing it to you, and refuse it because it doesn't sound easy in what you are looking for. Can you be like the psalmist and says, I've opened my ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Saints of God, what does the Spirit speak to the church? The Bible tells us the prophecy came not in old time by will of men, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. When I read this passage here, I'm reading to you what the Spirit is saying to the church. It is not me prophesying to you saying, yay for the Lord said, yay for the Lord said. No, that's me prophesying. Sometimes it can be a prophet lie. But if I go here, this is all true. Heaven and earth will pass and not one word will fail. You can believe this, put your life on the line for it. I promise you it won't let you down in the end. I promise you in the end you'll be justified. Let's read what he said here. Sacrifices and offering. Now, this is while all of this was going on. This is before Christ came. God is speaking of, I'm fed up with it. I don't like it. Sacrifices and offerings thou didst not. My ears has thou opened. Burnt offering for sin has thou not required. This is not God's requirement. What he is saying, you have not met the requirements of God by killing something dying. You have not met all of God's requirement, even when Jesus died, when you keep doing wrong and rely upon his death. You have got, you lost the message for what his death was about. Listen what he said. Then said I, this is what I said too. Every one of us must make this statement. This is what the psalmist is saying. He's speaking of himself at the time, but he's also speaking of one to come, Jesus Christ. Would make this same statement. When he recognized God was not pleased with your life based on some death of something else. God is not pleased with you for the death of a bull. And he's not pleased with you for the death of Jesus. He accepted atonement for your wrong for what Jesus did. Oh, for what you did. He accepted atonement for the death of Jesus Christ for what you did. He accepted that atonement, meaning to pay for that error, but he's not pleased with you. He's not accepting you for what you are. He accepted that atonement. He accepted the atonement of the bulls back then. He accepted the atonement of the goats. Why does Paul bring in Jesus all the time? Because he brings in Jesus to let the church know there's no more sacrifices for sin other than that which has happened through Jesus Christ. You don't keep your altars and keep on killing animals. The Jesus blood was adequate enough, but it was not to say you can hate your enemy. Then said I, this is what you ought to say. When you understand God is not pleased with you just because Jesus died. The psalmist understood God was not pleased with them because a bull was killed. Then said I, and guess why I love to quote that statement there? That's what's missing. And many of people that are coming to the church and going to the altar trying to get saved, and it never happened. Because they never make this statement from their heart. That's why you have to do it from the heart. The Bible said with the heart, man believes enough to start doing righteous. Or it leads him unto putting away the drugs. Then said I don't know if you're willing to say it. And if you really take a survey of honest people in our church this morning, there are not a lot of them want to say it honestly to God. What this psalmist said when he recognized God wasn't pleased with the bulls. God ain't pleased with the killing of the drug, of the turtle doves. Then said I. I'm talking about me now. I'm talking about me. I said that same thing. Then said I, lo, I come. in the volume of the book it is written of me. I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. Here is the psalmist saying, I'm going to have in my heart to not kill somebody. I'm not going to be lusting at your wife and want to take her. And I just don't do it because I'm going to hell. I'm going to have in my heart, I don't want to lust at your wife. I lust at your car. I want your house. I want your wallet. Want your credit card when you drop it. The psalmist said, I'm getting this thing down inside of me. That's why Jesus said, hey, you know, your old time said you should not commit adultery, but I'm saying if you look into lust, you commit adultery. The old time it said, thou shalt not kill, but I'm saying if you're angry with your brother, you're murderer. The old time it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. You was okay, you complied. That's why you fall from grace when you get under the law. Because under the law, you could hate your enemy. But under grace, you got to love your enemy. Under grace, you got to bless them that curse you. Under grace, you got to do good to them that despitefully use you. Oh, under grace, you're going to treat everybody, white, black, white, Mexicans, Hispanics. It doesn't matter what they are. You would go to Mexico, treat him right. You go to Africa and treat him like a man. You go to Canada and Russia, and I'm going to tell you something you don't know, but we get so many calls from, write letters from Russia, it is amazing. I once thought there was no righteous people in Russia. I failed to realize that the gospel went over the whole world. And just because every government go a certain way, that don't mean everybody in there lost their faith with God. That's why we make our mistakes. That's why we... Look what our government is allowing now. Same-sex marriage. Now, we ought not to preach on same-sex. Well, I might as well start preaching on homunging too then. Why you going to get on President Clinton for committing adultery and you let the homosexual do what they want to do? They all see it. Come on. Why you going to talk about the senator that laid with somebody? Shut your mouth up. You got a daughter right in there doing the same thing with another woman. You need to straighten her up. Then you try to talk about the senator. Somebody give God praise in here. I got to come against all of that wrong. You know, Clinton was with that Lewinsky. Oh, yeah, that was wrong. And them two women hugging up, too, is wrong. But preachers don't do that because you know what? I've experienced the recall, but it just didn't bother me. I've experienced people getting up, leaving church. I've experienced them about 100 joining me as partners when they first heard me preach. Hundreds. Then turn around and just disregard me. I've experienced that. But it haven't changed me. Because I'm not sending out a report to see what's popular. I got a mission. God's going to prepare you to meet him, saints. For the day will come, everyone, every knee will bow, every tongue. You will be able to go before him. Or if you follow this gospel, you'll be able to stand in the presence of the angels. And you'll be able to say, without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God is manifest in my life. I've been justified because I'm walking in the Spirit. Angels have seen me live holy. They marvel at the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven. You would say that godliness is received up in glory. Shout glory to God, somebody. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me close here this morning. Hallelujah. In the book of Hebrew again, as we close here, be real attentive to this teachings. This is what the writer is quoting again. Be back in Hebrew now. Verse number 8, he's quoting Psalms. Jesus is speaking of himself. Verse 7 and 8, let's read it again. Then said he, lo, I come. In the volume of the book it is written of me to do thy will, O God. Above, when he said sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and offering for sin, thou wouldest not, neither had pleasure therein, which were offered by the law. That's what people are trying to go back to and make Jesus the big offer sacrifice. Keep on being him, just him, just him, just him. Kill him again. The Bible said if we sin willfully after we receive the knowledge of the truth, there remain no more sacrifice for sin. It said we crucify Jesus Christ afresh. We put him to open shame. We cause him to get back on the cross again. When we just go and sin willfully. What if one sin with not a desire? Sin through oppression. Sin through oppression. The Bible said at that time God would have mercy and not sacrifice. He's going to have mercy upon the sinner, and he will have mercy on you. But his mercy is to lead you to a repentant life. It is not, and he will have mercy on you. He will have mercy on you again. He will forgive you again. But the thing is, you can't make it into heaven until you make up this statue here. This thing here, what he said. I come, then said I, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. And listen at verse 9. I come to do thy will, O God. He take away the first that he may establish the second. Now, what is he saying? The preachers will take that and say, see, God did away with the law. He took away the law. Now, what it is saying, he's taking away the burnt offerings and the sacrifices for sins, that he can establish a people that has made a covenant with him to do his will.
Thanks for watching the Refuge Temple Ministries broadcast with Bishop Wendell Archer. If you're in the Houston Humble area and you want to worship with us, we welcome you with open arms. We are located at 15400 Old Humble Road, Humble, Texas, 77396. Our service times are Sunday mornings at 10 a.m., Sunday night service at 7:30 p.m., Wednesday night Bible study at 7:30 p.m., or view our live broadcast at www.refugetemple.net. For more information about the ministry or to partner with us, call 281-441-1031. That's 281-441-1031. Or toll free at 1-866-480-1949. That's 1-866-480-1949. Or contact us online at www.refugetemple.net. Thank you, and may God bless you.